Okay, hi. Thank you very much for inviting me to this conference on technological sovereignty, which is so important, but unfortunately the technology isn't sovereign in the room and my slides are not able to be shown to you for some reason, and that's a shame because there's lots of images, but I will describe as much as I can. It's a visual topic. I'm going to talk mainly about London and the UK, but I think it is really relevant to the context here in Barcelona, in Europe more widely, in the West even more widely. I'm using London as a lens, really, and I am going to really focus on London and the UK, but in a way where the sort of outliers, where the pioneers, it's kind of as bad as it gets. And that really struck me when I got here to Barcelona yesterday, having not been here before. I mean, I know there's huge problems with gentrification, property prices, rising rents, Airbnb, some of the themes that we've touched upon. But the city feels so free. People are skateboarding around everywhere. There's no CCTV I can see. There's just lots of sort of small bars and cafes and restaurants. It's a completely different atmosphere to London, which is being so reconfigured at the moment, carved up and reshaped into these corporate private districts, and where public housing is at the same time being demolished. And these are some of the themes that I'm going to talk about. My presentation is going to be in two parts, really. The first part, I'm going to talk about a lot of the themes that I wrote about in a book I wrote in 2009 called Ground Control, which looked at the privatization of public space and the impact of the privatization of public space on the city, the segregation of the city, the kind of city environment that leads to. And that has some interesting parallels with the privatization of the digital public realm as well. And then in the second part of the talk, I'm going to talk more about where London and the UK is at now, because obviously that was really some years ago. And if the situation then was concerning, now we're in a completely different place. So, I mean, as I was saying to you, London is just changing. I said it's in two parts, but I am going to just give you an overview of London right now, because it's just an important sort of starting point. And we have, on the one hand, literally hundreds of housing estates in London are in the process of being demolished or are being earmarked for demolition. We have this new housing bill, which is coming in, which basically has changed the definition of affordable housing to now mean up to 80% of market rent or a starter home, so-called, for almost £500,000, which, interestingly, I think a policy is very much paralleled in a city like New York, where the definition of affordable housing is similarly sort of ludicrous. And again, he talked about language and the need for a totally new language. Housing and the sort of area I'm going to be talking to you about is just filled with this incomprehensible language. But while social affordable housing is being demolished, at the same time we're seeing 400 tower blocks in London in the process of going up, which are majority sold directly to foreign investors, which has led to a situation where London has had last year the second highest house prices in the world, outside of Monaco, and it's a sort of trickle-down of property price rises and so-called gentrification. This isn't really gentrification we're talking about. This is speculation displacement on a mass scale, which has taken over London, now is spreading out to other British cities, Manchester, Bristol, Edinburgh, and these same themes are in play there. It's a real estate casino economy that's underpinning all of this. And really, the sort of the big theme, it's this Thomas Piketty's
theme
in Capital, where rents from real estate so far exceed economic growth. What's the point of going to work if you are in the position of owning property? Your property will own far more than you ever can. Okay, but I said I was going to go back to the themes which underpin ground control, because they were sort of the context, I think, for some of what we have now in the UK. And the key sort of, the sort of canvas for the neoliberal city, the British neoliberal city, and the European neoliberal city, is the post-industrial city to a large extent. And it's the post-industrial opportunities of the former docks and factory spaces that you have here as much in Spain as we have. And this created this idea of what's known as regeneration, another hugely problematic term. And it was all premised on the idea of trickle down, create these new spaces for financial services, iconic art galleries, Guggenheim, Bilbao being a great example, and that wealth will trickle down to the rest of the city, which needs it. And of course, that was a complete myth. And what has happened instead is that you get the increasingly two-speed economies in cities, and a culture of exclusion, segregation, and you also have the creation of these very sterile places where so much effort has been made to create these wonderful privatized quarters, but actually they're all horribly the same wherever in the world you may be. They're all policed by private security, CCTV, and they're not very fun places to be. And actually looking at your just here where we are now, how much of a better space this is than the equivalent art spaces that we have in London. So one of the reasons that these spaces, which are really common in the UK, have become so overwhelmed with private security, and this relates directly to the digital technology agendas that we're discussing here, is down to what academics call the mass privatization thesis, because where property is privately owned, it automatically brings with it private security. That's not as a result of public demand for growing policing. It's just simply like a shopping mall, an office space will have its security guard. So as these spaces of the city have become more and more privately owned, you see the security coming with it. And every single new development in the UK is now rolled out on this model. And this is where my slides come in, but you can't see them. But the slide I'm looking at the moment is the centre of Liverpool, which is called Liverpool One, which is a huge 34-acre privately owned site, now a sort of shopping centre, sort of so-called mixed-use residential office space place. The whole centre of Liverpool, policed by private security, where I'm told, I was proudly told when I visited, CCTV covers every inch of the site. Similarly, Bristol has Cabot Circus, a similar sort of development. Every city centre will have one or two of the really big ones, but then there'll be like little places. And for all of you who are familiar with London, you know, any new small-scale development will similarly be built on this private model. And I'm sure that there are developments like this in Spain. You know, there are developments like this in other European cities that I've visited, but they're just not many. You know, it may be like 5% where the streets and the public spaces and the squares of the city are privately owned. Still, nearly all of the city stays in public hands, and that's where the difference is. And that's where I think it's important that you look at what's happening, because actually it could be coming to a place near you soon. And to some extent, we've imported these trends from America, where this sort of privatized waterfront development model really began in the 1970s. But we imported it and we turbocharged it, and to some extent, we made it worse, because in the US they have a constitution, and actually they have more democratic rights about around the city to some extent. For those of you who are familiar with London, sometimes I'm asked, you know, isn't this model of a private landlord owning a large part of the city exactly how the Georgian squares and terraces of London, which are some of the most beautiful places in the city and in other British cities, isn't this how they were? They were created in the 18th century and early 19th century before the advent of democracy. And that is absolutely right. You know, places like Bedford Square, in Bloomsbury and, you know, other Georgian squares. This was exactly right, that was the model of an aristocratic landlord owning the place. And they're lovely places to wander around, and they have a garden square in the middle. But what you don't see today is that at the time these places were surrounded by high fences and security guards and sentry boxes, and actually the public of the city weren't allowed in. And as local government and local democracy grew in power, there was an increasing public demand for this to change. It was reflected in two parliamentary inquiries, and ultimately by the mid to late 19th century, you saw the London County Council. So it's actually city government which took the lead in this, and also central government saying the private landlords had to take down the fences and the security and open the streets to the public. And thereafter, the streets and the public places of the city became local authority control. Now, every country has its own system of property and land ownership, and in the UK, we have a feudal system where our property ownership is first and foremost held by the crown, and thereafter it sort of trickles down in complicated ways. I'm not sure what the system of arrangements is here in Spain, but you know, there will be arrangements when private owners come in and want to take over large parts of the city. There will be ways of doing it, and I'm sure they will interact with your democratic processes. So just to sort of say a few more aspects of these sorts of places, which are democratically unaccountable because they are not under city council municipal control. They also are very restrictive places. There's a whole host of activities you can't do. There's no skateboarding, rollerblading, even eating and drinking in some places. No filming, no taking photographs, and absolutely critical to this, no political protest. And that is the litmus test of why these places are not democratic places. And that's why it struck me so much, actually, all the skateboarders around Barcelona, because skateboarding has become this huge thing in London. You know, skateboarders are not allowed hardly anywhere, and we've got these little spikes on squares in all new developments, which are sort of anti-skateboarding spikes, basically. So it's another signifier of how public the space actually is. And then we've got the CCTV technologies, and of course these are now all the time rolling out more and more innovations, and now we have drones which are routinely used by more and more UK police forces, and drones actually are military technology. They were first developed for use in Iraq and Afghanistan, and they were modified for civilian use first time in LA, I think, in 2005, and now these military technologies are actually coming to define how we police the urban environment. And there's been some really good work done on this area by British academic called Steve Graham, who wrote a book called Cities Under Siege, who looks very much at how military technologies have been actually imported into policing the urban environment in Western cities. And he draws this analogy where military technologies often used in the global south are re-imported back into the cities of the global north for their states to police parts of the city. And all this private security creates a rather unpleasant environment, and you know, one of the big arguments I tried to make in Ground Control is that it actually creates a much more fearful place. I think in some ways that's obvious, because if there's security all around you, you feel that there's a need for it. But the problem is that often it is popular, because it's counterintuitive, the issue of security. And if people are asked, you want it, you know, it will reduce crime. Quite often they will say, well, you know, of course we'd like that. And then the terror agenda both promotes and justifies the use of ever more security. The slide I was going to show next is the picture of St. Paul's Cathedral with the Occupy protest in front of it in 2011. And the question is, why did that protest happen there? And my next slide is of a place called Paternoster Square, which is just around the corner from St. Paul's Cathedral, and is where the Occupy protest wanted to be, because that's the headquarters of the London Stock Exchange, and they were initially called Occupy London Stock Exchange. But Paternoster Square is, like all these places I've been talking about, entirely privately owned and privately controlled. The owners immediately got an injunction. The protesters weren't allowed anywhere near it, and actually what emerged is that the entire space, public space, the entirety of the square mile of the City of London is actually a series of privately owned estates. And there is no genuinely public space at all in the City of London, apart from this small area outside St. Paul's Cathedral, and also a small area outside the Bank of England, which is often where protests gather and begin as well. And the other Occupy protest was in Finsbury Square, which is outside the square mile and part of Islington City Council. And that's a really interesting point, I think, because this model of private ownership and private control began in the late 1980s in the UK with the deregulation of finance and the creation of Canary Wharf and the Broadgate Centre, which created these entirely privatised places in the image of business to meet the needs of business. But what you've seen now is that they've come in to every part of the city and have become the template for all development in the UK. And this is creating, as I said, a far more fearful and distrustful city, all this security all around us. And I think one of the reasons for that is because it's removing our sense of personal and collective responsibility for each other, which is that idea of, you know, when you walk down the streets of a busy city, when you walk down busy streets in the city, it's that unconscious interaction that everyone has between strangers. And that is what keeps places safe. To an extent, this is Jane Jacobs' idea of eyes on the street, but it's more just us all unconsciously watching each other. We create that safety, and all these external controls are undermining that safety and actually increasing fear of crime massively. And we have this huge paradox, which is that actually in Britain and in America, crime is going down. It's been going down for the last 20 years, and yet fear of crime is soaring. And I would say this is one of the reasons why. And I think Denmark provides a good example of this, because Denmark has very similar levels of crime to Britain, according to the European Crime and Safety Survey, which they say are for similar reasons of urbanisation, a large population of young people, and a binge-drinking culture. But Denmark also has very low levels of fear, which correlate directly with happiness, and Denmark's always scoring very high on these surveys, whereas Britain is quite the opposite. So that's basically my privatisation of public space, ground control sort of side of what I wanted to say. I don't know how much time I've got left. I was just going to say a little bit about where we're at now. When I finished ground control, it was post-crash, and actually I felt, you know, possibly a window was opening up for alternatives, but of course I was wildly out in that respect. And the situation is far, far more extreme than it was at that time. And we've seen this housing crisis really take off in London and the UK more widely, driven by these enormous land values and the speculation in real estate, which is driven by the flood of global capital into London and in the UK, facilitated by a very unregulated tax regime, which has led to many people comparing the lack of regulation and transparency. Just simply, London is one massive tax haven with a lot of corrupt money coming into the city. We have 44,000 companies in London registered to offshore companies. We don't know who's behind those. The Economist, not, you know, the most radical publication in the world, says the majority of those are likely to be corrupt, and a lot of this is driving the London property market. Political instability is also driving the London property market. We have a huge amount of investment from Russian, Ukrainian oligarchs. It's a complex picture of all sorts of investment. We also have sovereign wealth funds from Qatar, Malaysia, all coming into London. And we have a sort of massive interest from a growing Chinese, Asian middle class who are just keen to buy property in London because that's a good investment. So property is basically a commodity in London, and it's just something you trade in. It's got better returns than anything else. And that has huge impacts on Londoners. It's impossible to buy property in London. Nobody in this room would be able to afford... I don't know, I'm guessing really. but I mean, you know, a two-bedroom flat in a new apartment in a new development in sort of zone two, which is not central London, it's sort of just outside, could be, you know, around sort of £700,000, which is, you know, far beyond the multiples that people can buy, even on very high incomes. At the same time, this is linking into a soaring rental market, with the average Londoner spending more than 50% of their income on rent, and according to medical research by psychiatrists, they estimate that spending more than 30% of income on rent causes mental health issues. The rental market is completely unregulated, there's no security, you can only sign a contract for 6 months, and the deregulation is leading to huge exploitation in that sector, which I don't really have time to go into. But it strikes me that there's a parallel here also with what's been happening in Barcelona, where the PAM activist I met yesterday said that where foreclosures were the main issue, now actually increasingly it's rents. That's why people are coming to PAM. So the casino economy is actually making rental issues the key ones. So while we've got this sort of context, at the same time, we are demolishing all of these hundreds and hundreds of council estates, and I have just images after images now that I can't show you. One here, the Haygate estate in London, home to 3,000 people, was demolished a couple of years ago. It's been replaced by somewhere called Elephant Park by the Australian developer Lendlease, where prices range from $750,000 to $1 million two-bedroom apartment. It's been made quite clear why the government has been so keen to develop this policy of estate demolition, which they call estate regeneration. And this is down to Neil Smith, the American academic's idea of the rent gap.
I això when there's such parla, a big en remet als Estats Units, quan hi havia una gran diferència entre el valor de la terra i el valor potencial de la terra, el que es podia obtenir. I Lord Adonis, que va ser un membre laborista, anomenat pels conservadors per la Comissió d'Infraestructura, un dels urbanistes més importants de Londres, deia això en un informe que va escriure. La terra que té el Consell de la Ciutat de Londres és molt gran a la zona de Londres i està situada en les zones on la terra val més. Per tant, ens hauríem d'adaptar als desenvolupaments del mercat i al preu de mercat. Aquí ens dona una idea, és aquest terreny té valor, n'hauríem d'extreure el màxim valor. I aquí deien, tenim un problema de vivenda a Londres, l'única manera d'aturar-ho és si venem aquesta terra al màxim preu, això ens ajudarà a construir més apartaments a la perifèria. Sí, però el que no diuen és que aquests apartaments no serà habitatge social o habitatge a un preu assequible. Per tant, en comptes de solucionar el problema de la manca d'habitatge, el que s'està fent senzillament és construir més, sense que sigui habitatge a un preu assequible. Les persones que vivien de l'edifici, que he explicat que el van enderrocar, bàsicament els van desplaçar fora de Londres, cosa que va augmentar la pressió en aquelles àrees.
And the residents,
i els residents,
Margaret Thatcher's policy
perquè
of allowing
la política de Margaret Thatcher de permetre a la gent comprar l'habitatge social, que era l'emblema dels anys 80, eren els residents que més perjudicats, perquè els van donar molt pocs diners quan van tirar a terra aquest edifici.
They have been kicked out of London,
i els van fer fora de Londres. Va ser una situació, és una política escandalosa.
I'm sorry if this is like, you know, quite a complicated picture of
és un panorama una mica complicat
in a different housing
coses, d'un mercat immobiliari diferent del d'aquí, però penso que dona una idea de com de gran és aquesta especulació immobiliària al preu de la terra a Londres i al Regne Unit i el desplaçament de les persones.
Vàrem
tenir eleccions, Sadiq Khan és el nou alcalde de Londres, laborista, en el marc que té per treballar, en aquest marc legislatiu, amb una nova llei sobre habitatge, penso que podrà fer molt poca cosa el nou alcalde. Hi ha un tema més gran de saber a veure si ell aturarà una mica aquesta planificació que hi ha per anar tirant a terra edificis. Ara també tenim el tema del Brexit, la Theresa May. El que puc dir és que les coses a Espanya semblen que estan tan malament amb milions de persones que poden ser desnonades. Bé, això ha fet que sortissin aquests moviments d'activistes. Potser a Londres les coses s'estan posant tan malament que potser hi haurà també una solució o l'aparició de moviments com aquí a Espanya, perquè aquesta crisi de l'habitatge està creant unes divisions que ens han portat també al present en el Brexit. Moltes gràcies.
Thank you, Anna.
Moltes gràcies, Anna.
I would like to introduce
the
following discussion.
Els propers ponents.
We have here today Anna Minton. Thank you for your presentation. She's a writer, journalist, and academic, and she's the author of Ground Control, Fear and Happiness in the 21st Century City. We have also Galapin, Participatorian Districts. She's working on the Participatorian Districts Department, and she's the Consigliere of Ciutat Vella District. And also we have here with us Hilary Wainwright. She's a sociologist, a political activist, also a feminist and socialist. And she's co-editor of the Red Paper magazine. And it is important also to notice she's her experience in the early 80s when she was working on the Popular Planning Unit in the Government of London. Just for the discussion, I have prepared some words to introduce the discussion.
Probably
housing high prices is probably one of the most dramatic illness in the 21st century cities. Spain has become an scandalous example of the speculation and the corruption operating for decades, exploiting the basic right to housing, thousands of evictions, gentrification, uncontrolled wave of tourism or financial speculative investments. At the same time, we have an emergent significant and controversial model based on private digital platforms as Airbnb, exploiting social cooperation for profit, around 40 million a year only in Barcelona, while radically challenging city council efforts to guarantee housing rights. The problem, obviously, is not the cooperation. The problem is the social damage of this model, with no regulation, with opacity in the data management and the infrastructure, and obviously a centralization of benefits. If we talk about alternative and policies, we have the smart city model, which put the technology in the center to solve almost everything, but in the process of design public and common policies, we need a model which put the citizens' movements and the struggles in the center to attend the cooperation and the richness of knowledge and practices embedded on them from a common perspective, including the socialization also of benefits. This is why we should work to the notion of or the model of democratic cities. In this sense, there are a lot of initial ideas in which we can think, for example, a very huge initiative as the regulation of the private sector and also the private property, but also we need, and this is one of the main goals of BITS initiative, and this is the promotion of technological sovereignty, providing, for example, public common digital infrastructure, promoting free and open knowledge, and promoting also the data sovereignty to the citizens. And also in the housing problem, we have a lot of interesting experience in this sense, like cooperativism and also how from the public and from the citizen sector we can promote alternative platforms to promote the cooperation. In this sense, I just would like to invite Hilary and Gala to discuss to have a dialogue between these two experiences in Barcelona and London, this situated knowledge, and also discussing the problems on privatizing and the speculation, also the problems with technology and platform, but also to think in terms of alternatives. Attending our experience inside and outside of the government.
Les experiències que tenim aquí a Barcelona I a fora.
Okay, great. So good afternoon. I was talking. I could speak in Catalan.
M'han dit que podia parlar en català. Yeah, és veritat?
Great.
Sí.
So, I have. Bé, menos mal perquè m'havia preparat en català. Bé, primer, gràcies per la invitació I com no sé si em podré quedar fins al final, també agrair a l'equip, a l'Ània, a la Susi, a la Thais, al Toret, a l'Héctor I al Jou, l'organització de BITS, així com el Gerardo deia aquest matí, no? Que com a càrrecs públics tenim poc temps per pensar I agraïm poder tenir espais que ens obliguin a fer-ho. Jo faré una introducció breu perquè entenc que això estava concebut més com un diàleg I entenc que el que és interessant també és que es puguin fer preguntes I que tinguem més amb el debat, no aniré al quid de la qüestió, no? Quines polítiques públiques en temps d'habitatge s'han fet, no només a la ciutat de Barcelona, sinó a l'estat espanyol. Sí que puntualitzaré dues coses. Per una banda, el que ja coneixem, no? La manca d'habitatge públic que tenim a la ciutat de Barcelona i en general a l'estat espanyol, en comparació també amb les ràtios europees, això per una banda. Per una altra, com les polítiques públiques han deixat pas, no? O han fomentat la compra com una forma d'accés a l'habitatge durant molts anys. I això també a la ciutat de Barcelona és especialment rellevant, en el sentit que tenim molt poc habitatge públic i tenim també un parc d'habitatge en lloguer molt minso, no? Crec que està estimat en un 25%. I això fa que sigui molt complicat aquest accés a l'habitatge. L'Arnau comentava, no?, com canviar aquest frame o com introduir dins del frame de les smart city o de l'ús de la tecnologia per la ciutat el concepte de democratic city. Jo crec que té dos parts. Una és la garantia, dos parts fonamentals, podríem aprofundir més. Una és la garantia de drets bàsics, i en aquest sentit l'habitatge és un d'ells. I una altra és anar una mica més enllà del que coneixem habitualment com és aquell espai públic o privat, no?, i parlar de la col·laboració i de la cooperació ciutadania-administracions i de tenir això, espais de cogovernança. Això ho apunto perquè ho retomaré després al final. Llavors, sí que m'havia centrat molt, com que suposava que ens tocava fer la part pràctica. Com a regidora del districte de Ciutat Vella, que és un dels districtes més afectats per la massificació turística a la ciutat, però també com a experiència personal, no?, com a veïna de la Barceloneta que fa molts anys que hi visc i que és un dels districtes, dels barris també més afectats pel turisme, i de fet és un dels barris on vam començar a denunciar la proliferació dels apartaments turístics. Ara el major problema és els il·legals, en aquell moment denunciaven també els legals. Sí que, i això ho hem compartit crec que en moltes ciutats, no?, hi ha un tret diferencial, hi ha un moment en què hi ha una diferència entre l'aparició d'espais, de plataformes com Airbnb, Booking, HomeAway. Evidentment sempre parlem d'Airbnb perquè és qui té el prestigi i qui s'emporta tot o la gran majoria del volum del negoci, però d'alguna manera jo crec que no hem d'oblidar que existeixen altres plataformes. Llavors, què ens passa amb aquestes plataformes en relació amb l'habitatge? Fa poc van publicar un informe que parlava de l'impacte del lloguer vacacional al preu de l'habitatge, que a més ha anat pujant. Llavors, crec que també és de justícia dir, no és només el lloguer vacacional el que influeix en la pujada de preu de l'habitatge, hi ha molts altres factors. De fet, a Nou Barris, per exemple, tenim també una pujada del preu del lloguer i en canvi tenim molt pocs habitatges, molt pocs apartaments turístics il·legals. Tot i així, en districtes com Ciutat Vella o com Gràcia o com l'Eixample, en el cas de Ciutat Vella, per exemple, un 80% dels edificis o dels habitatges que es compren es dediquen per inversió, sí que el lloguer vacacional té un impacte important. I aquí, què ens passa amb aquestes plataformes digitals que permeten aquesta proliferació d'apartaments turístics il·legals i de pèrdua d'un bé fonamental com és l'habitatge per passar a ser exclusivament un negoci orientat al sector turístic. Per una banda, ens trobem amb un punt de partida, diguem-ne, erroni, no?, que es parla sempre d'economia col·laborativa, quan en realitat el que veiem és que tenim grans corporacions que fan una explotació turística a la ciutat sense donar cap tipus de contrapartida, i aquí podríem entrar tant en l'àmbit fiscal, però també en les contrapartides socials i en aquelles contrapartides que tenen a veure amb atenir-se, no?, amb respecte a les normatives i la legislació local. I aquí ho hem comentat moltes vegades també amb diferent gent de l'Ajuntament, no?, què ens passaria si aquestes plataformes estiguessin fetes en software lliure, tinguessin les dades obertes i poguéssim accedir-ne a l'explotació de les seves dades, no?, com això canviaria i efectivament aquesta capacitat de col·laboració i aquesta capacitat també d'avançar-nos com a administració, aquelles tendències que estan generant seria molt, molt major. Llavors, estem parlant d'un operador global però que ha de poder tenir responsabilitats locals que ara mateix no ho té. Ens al contrari, el que hem fet és demanar-li, tal com diu la legislació catalana, demanar-li les dades d'aquells apartaments turístics que están publicitando de manera irregular a Airbnb y demanarle que deje de publicitarlos y se han negado, lo cual ha supuesto que creo que somos la primera ciudad de España que ha iniciado un procedimiento de multa a plataformas como Airbnb o como a HomeAway. Llavors, primer concepte, no, és a economia col·laborativa falsejada, per dir-ho d'alguna manera, no? I aquesta necessitat també de caminar cap a l'apertura de les dades i el treballar amb un altre tipus de tecnologia. El segon és un fenomen global que ha de tenir responsabilitats locals. Hi ha una altra que no té a veure tant amb la dimensió tecnològica, però que sí que és en la seva forma d'operar aquestes plataformes, i crec que aquí sí que Airbnb és l'exemple més il·lustratiu, és de quina manera també construeixen hegemonia. En el cas d'Airbnb ens trobem en que en realitat més d'un 60% de la gent que està publicitant apartaments està publicitant més d'un apartament, no? Que són multipropietaris, i en canvi l'hegemonia de discurs que s'ha generat és l'ús d'aquestes plataformes per poder arribar a final de mes. No? Aquesta construcció d'hegemonia que fa, per mi Airbnb sincerament és el millor lobby del segle XXI, davant dels lobbies clàssics, no? Que d'alguna manera només es dediquen a pressionar al poder polític, bueno, poder polític, als polítics, lo del poder, després si voleu discutim on és exactament, però el que tenim és un lobby que és capaç d'articular això, un discurs hegemònic en relació amb les seves pràctiques, fent servir com a intermediaris els propis usuaris de la seva plataforma, però al final amb un objectiu que acaba sent la seva pròpia recaptació. I en aquest sentit ens trobem també en plataformes, torno a posar l'exemple de Airbnb, no? Que serveixen com a mediadors i que a més, per mi això és un element important, és que acaben sent un pas obligat per poder participar d'aquest tipus de model de negoci. És a dir, tot i que ara la regulació a la ciutat de Barcelona fos diferent, no? i obríssim l'aixeta per tenir llicència d'apartament turístic, no el regulessin tot, el pas obligatori ara mateix són les plataformes com Airbnb o com a Booking o com a HomeAway. I llavors aquest pas obligatori i alhora també aquest desentendre's d'una col·laboració amb l'administració pública i de tenir-se als espais o a les normatives vigents genera un gap que impedeix això, que hi hagi un lideratge públic i que acaba abocant a haver de pensar o acabar pensant només en termes de fiscalitat, no? Com fem perquè aquesta gent pagui impostos, quan en realitat no es tracta només de que aquesta gent es pagui impostos, sinó que com a governs, diguem-ne, municipals, tenim la responsabilitat de governar la ciutat i en aquest sentit vol dir garantir també drets i per tant fer que els operadors privats puguin fer benefici, però sempre sense vulnerar drets fonamentals com és l'habitatge. I llavors, lligant-ho també amb el tema que deia de l'economia col·laborativa falsejada i de l'hegemonia, jo crec que hi ha determinats sectors on es focalitza molt en aquesta sharing economy, no? El no poder, en nous models de negoci a través de la sharing economy, i aquí jo crec que el que hem de focalitzar són entre les bones i males pràctiques. No es tracta de posar en qüestió l'economia col·laborativa quan es fa bé o la sharing economy, sinó que el que es tracta és d'avaluar aquestes bones o males pràctiques. I aquí crec que Gerardo també, la veritat que he tingut tantes converses amb Gerardo aquest matí, que no sé si ho deia aquesta setmana, no sé si ho deia aquest matí o ho hem comentat aquesta setmana, un dels temes que jo crec que és una gran assignatura pendent dels governs locals, sobretot a l'estat espanyol, la veritat desconec el cas de Londres, és com gestionem, com fem una gestió pública de les dades, no? I en aquest sentit, una gestió pública de les dades que ens permeti també, i aquí estic pensant no només en Airbnb, sinó estic pensant també en portals com Idealista, com Fotocasa, com Habitaclia i demés, que ens permetin tenir una bona radiografia de quin és el mercat del lloguer i quin és el mercat de l'habitatge que tenim a la ciutat de Barcelona, per a partir d'aquí sí pensar aquestes alternatives. Mentre, evidentment, es van fent polítiques públiques d'habitatge, com no pot ser d'una altra manera, no? Entre d'altres, augmentar el parc públic o introduir noves formes de tinència, com és el cohousing, no? Cooperatives de cohousing. Però aquesta obertura pública de dades jo crec que també ens ajudaria, i amb això ja acabo, per no allargar-me molt, a tancar un debat que va sortint de manera reiterada i que crec que a ciutats com a Berlín i Amsterdam n'han tingut també, no? Que és la possibilitat de fer una plataforma local per oferir nosaltres els apartaments turístics que són legals, que jo personalment crec que, bueno, crec que seria un fracàs, l'únic que és un debat que està obert, perquè en realitat això estem parlant d'un fenomen global, el públic no és local, és global, no? Airbnb té el prestigi digital que cal tenir per poder tenir tot el flux i el tràfic de gent, però sí que ens hauria de permetre aquesta obertura de dades i jo crec que això hauria de ser, no sé, un mínim bàsic democràtic a l'hora d'operar en una ciutat en relació amb béns fonamentals com l'habitatge, no? que poguessin gaudir tots de l'accés a les dades per conèixer, per una banda, l'impacte real i per una altra banda, això, com anar construint alternatives. Jo crec que aquí, a més, també per democratitzar fins i tot a nivell econòmic l'accés a, bueno, tant amb l'habitatge com amb determinats tipus de model, bueno, de models de negoci que parteixen de l'economia col·laborativa però que ara mateix estan monopolitzats per alguns pocs agents. Llavors jo amb això acabaria, que suposo que m'estic enrotllant, i li donaria a Anna la paraula.
Thank you, Gala.
Okay, everybody. Well, I'm really happy to be here and kind of stimulated both by what Barcelona is doing now, but also by the fact that I think maybe one of the reasons why it's possible for Barcelona to be such a beacon of rebel cities is because of what it did in the past, that it created alternatives, you know, in the struggle, you know, particularly around cooperatives and the power. And so I just want to do two things. First, I just quickly want to say that Anna's description is absolutely, you know, accurate. And I was looking at her slides, and I live in Hackney, part of London. I live in Hackney, which is just, it's away from the centre, but near the city. And all her pictures of public housing is my daily experience, you know, that Hackney, as you know, it's like Hackney, really public place, you know, all the housing, it's all public, almost completely, not totally, there's some private sort of old streets, but it's mainly public, and it's got all these names which reflect, you know, the old founders of the welfare state, the Beatrice Webber state, you know, it's got this, you feel you're back in 1945, you know, beautiful public parks, and then you just think, oh my God, the housing bill. And you know that Hackney is almost like a first target, because already the house prices are very, very high. You know, my nieces and nephews, who I'd like to live near, they can't afford housing there. I mean, I just got a lease, not even an ownership, but a sort of lease. Long lease. Anyway, but the other thing about which links to Paul's point about Jeremy Corbyn and the new political opportunity, though very precarious, in Britain, which is that there was resistance to the housing bill by tenants, public housing tenants. And there is a new mood of people feeling they've got a right to protest. I mean, the importance of Jeremy Corbyn is not just that his policies are to the left, but that he legitimates and he calls for action. You know, so he says, when he makes a speech, he says, don't come to me, don't lobby me, don't come to Parliament. Get together, take action. And so these tenants, you know, not just under his leadership, but under their own leadership, but legitimated by him and by the new atmosphere in the Labour Party, have taken action. And now the question is whether the municipality, the council, will have the courage to say no to the government, which is a bit
doubtful,
but you know, you never know, and if Corbyn maintains his position and supports rebel councils, and in a way, maybe another dimension to the rebel city network is councils like Hackney. I mean, it's a small municipal, well, not that small, Hackney, municipal council, but the rebel city network, I think, needs to include municipalities that are in struggle, you know, that are not necessarily, you know, they're not necessarily in power because their powers have been chopped away by Mrs. Thatcher, Tony Blair, and then Cameron and now May. So they're in struggle, and in a way they would gain confidence from meeting all of you. And I hope, you know, as I'll be inviting Gala and other power people to come to Hackney to meet with the tenants and help give them that sort of confidence and know-how. Anyway, so that's just to back up and think about the future collaboration before we have a new Labour government. And anyway, just briefly, you know, when you read, I don't know how much it's publicised, but you read all the hostility to Jeremy Corbyn from MPs, it's precisely because he is supporting and coming from extra-parliamentary action and politics, and the MPs, there's a terrible tradition in Britain linked to the royal earl of the crown, where MPs make this vow to the crown, not to the people. And that vow to the crown is a vow to the
diferent
state.
So it has a kind of, gives the state and parliament a corona, this sort of no al poble,
almost sacred democratic
Corbyn,
status,
de
democratic
in
inverted commas. So somebody like Jeremy Corbyn, who's not just radical in his policies, but in
no
his methods,
radical,
is seen as a threat to
methods,
the state.
El veuen com
and
una
a threat to
per
MPs themselves.
I una amenaça contra els propis diputats.
So what I thought I'd do, because I was a bit nervous about coming to a situation that is so advanced that, you know, and that, you know, I'm not sure what I can contribute. So I thought, well, I did have this, talking about the ghost of Mrs. Thatcher, I am here feeling great pleasure at helping to bury her ghost, because I worked in the, well, the county council that Anna talked about, the government of London, which was abolished by Mrs. Thatcher. And I'll just give you some idea of why, and why, you know, in a way, our ghosts, were the victims of Thatcher, are now rising, not ghosts, but real palpable living forces. Because what we did was, I was leading the group called the Popular Planning Unit, and I felt a bit when Francesca talked about certain feelings of ambivalence about being in the government. And we too, coming from social movements, in my case from the women's movement especially, we had this phrase, working in and against the state. So we were in the state, there's no denying that. We were even called officers because the British state is based on the military. So I was a local government officer, you know. And yet we'd come there from social movements, and our job in the Popular Planning Unit was to open up the resources of the state to popular movements. So it was directly to turn the state from being a power of domination into being a resource for power as transformative capacity, the power of citizens associating and individually, but stimulated to associate. So that was our job, and in a way, it's a new, well, I don't want to over, you know, theorize it, but it indicates a slightly different model of participation from the traditional one, where, you know, the notion of participation in planning is the municipality presents the plan drawn up in the municipality to the people who then make, you know, produce changes. And talking to Javier from Decidem, you know, I can see that you've been doing that in a really meaningful way, so people's responses don't just get deleted and put in the bin, but they're really followed up and they become the basis of policy. But we, partly for resource reasons and other reasons, we didn't work like that, though probably the planning department did. We were more part of the economic and employment part of the Greater London Council, the government of London. And we started, because of our experience in movement, we started from a very different understanding of knowledge from the one that tends to dominate public institutions, and which still does, and I think explains why public institutions are so slow, you know, so slow to kind of understand how to respond to the new situation. So we, you know, in the women's movement, for example, but other movements too, we started to value what we call practical knowledge, or what Hayek actually called tacit knowledge, but he understood it just in terms of the individual tacit knowledge, and that being the basis of the entrepreneur and the market, the coordination is only through the market. But we were valuing tacit knowledge, but our experience in movements was about how we, a movement, its very essence in a way is about sharing that tacit knowledge. So women's feminist consciousness raising groups was sharing knowledge which is completely demeaned and denigrated, knowledge which could be called gossip or emotion or, you know, irrelevant. irrelevant to public policy. We said, no, no, actually, our emotions are gossip, are about real, you know, experiences of what's happening to children, about the problems of childcare, about the problems of violence against women. You know, we want to share these, and through sharing them and articulating them, then developing policies. So we had a notion of sharing practical and tacit knowledge, and that being a basis of public policy. So what would that mean when it was the basis of a whole strategy of participation? So we thought, well, let's start with people's resistance and conflict, because where people resist, it's usually an indication that they've got a vision, even if it's implicit and tacit. They've got a vision of an alternative. So we started from where people were resisting. One of the main case I was involved in was resisting the city airport, which was a stimulus to a kind of massive development of the kind that Anna's talked about. It was an airport very near the city centre. It was for city people. You know, you could just, you know, get your chauffeur. I mean, you know, the city people would get their chauffeur to drive to the city, and, you know, to the airport in like 10 minutes from the office, hop onto a plane to Frankfurt, do the deal, come back, be home, you know, so it was all completely for the city, and it was the idea of regenerating the doctrines which had been, you know, completely neglected in terms of any public investment, regenerated through this speculative, well, initial speculative and then real project of an airport. And then what's happened actually is, you know, massive tablets of the kind that Anna describes all around the docks, which were replacing public housing. So we went to the meetings that were saying no from the citizens, because our public mandate was for the development of a new dock facility and for social housing and businesses around, small businesses around the docks. So we supported the people resisting and then said, well, you know, do you have an alternative? And they'd say, yeah, of course we have alternatives. There are lots of ideas. We haven't brought them together. Okay, so how do you want to bring them together? And they'd say, well, what about, and they were just brainstorming, what about a centre in the neighbourhood? We could call it the People's Plan Centre, and people could come and pool their ideas. So we said, you know, we had a big budget. You know, my popular planning unit had about a million or more. I mean, it seems amazing now, but anyway, on supporting popular initiatives. So, okay, so we could fund the People's Plan Centre. And then they said, well, but, you know, how will we organise it? Because we're some of us are retired, but we're busy with our families. Others are not retired, or some are still at school. So how can we do it? Well, we'd like to employ some people, they said. So, okay, we could fund that. So basically what happened then was like the production of an alternative plan through the People's Plan Centre, and then they employed local people, local businessman, local young person, local woman who's mainly looking after her kids, and then a young woman had just left school. And we went round bingo halls, you know, bingo's a big thing in London, in England, and laundrettes, and just went round gathering people's ideas, and then helped to pull it together as a very, you know, imaginative plan with very good visuals. And in a way, it addresses Paul's point about complexity, because it wasn't a survey, do you want a dock or an airport? It was like, okay, how would you like to see these docks? It's called the Royal Docks, so it gives you an idea. It was called Imperial Dock, you know, big ships from Jamaica and India and the British colonies. So it clearly was, you know, it was no longer, you know, viable, but there were other ideas about different kinds of docks, you know, more European, you know, there were different businesses, processing. There was all sorts of ideas that came out of it, but it was a way of addressing that need for complexity. And the principle there was by drawing on the knowledge, bringing together, sharing the sort of tacit practical knowledge of those that used and lived in the area. So I was thinking, well, if we took, we were doing this in the 80s, so there was no ICT, we were just working with conventional technologies. It was mainly labor, mainly the the time of people who'd come from the movements, had experience of popular education or of helping to sort of stimulate and develop ideas on the ground. So we had no new technology tools, so what would it be like if we had those tools? That's what I thought would be interesting, to take some of the methodology of the government of London under a radical leadership, which is very similar in a way, the political principle is very similar to yours here in Barcelona, of working radical, with social movements. So what could we learn from that historical experience? I think learning from the past is crucial, because in a way Thatcher destroyed the Great London Council for political reasons. It was not Council, just about money, you know, and spending. It was because, as her right-hand man, Norman Tebbit, said, this is modern socialism and we must kill it.
Perquè in a way, this was actually modern, on the cusp of the process that
Anna describes. It was just as this speculative momentum was beginning.
And
the cases that we supported, like the struggle against the Royal Docks, and then another one was in Queen Street, a place very near the centre of London, just opposite Westminster, near the river, and the big property developer from the city was wanting to develop there, but local people had come together, resisted, developed, you know, without, you know, just through their own initiative, an alternative plan. So the GLC said, yeah, we support you, and we have some powers of compulsory purchase that Anna referred to. So we'll buy the land, make it public, but we won't, because the GLC leadership had come from these movements too. And so they said, well, we won't plan it. You know, the GLC had a huge, fantastically respected planning department. But no, we won't hand it over to our professional planners who have kind of scientific knowledge in a very, you know, mechanical sense. Well, not mechanical, but a very sort of narrowly centralised sense. We actually trust your capacities and knowledge, and if you need resources from our architects or whatever, then fine, but we'll support your plan. And that's what happens. So now the area around called Queen Street is actually really, I mean, there have been problems and difficulties under Thatcher and so on, but it's a really human area. It's a
very human
cooperative restaurants and social housing. Anyway, so we could only do two or three of these examples. So what if we'd had IT tools? How could it be different?
And
so I'm just thinking, this is just brainstorming, but I was just thinking, you know, one idea would be, you know, we could sort of map resistance. So we would draw up the resistances we knew of through people connected to the GLC. But then we could make a map of what we knew and then crowdsource, so people could come back and say, yeah, there's a resistance here. Or, you know, so maybe, you know, thinking about Airbnb, I imagine, talking to people over lunch, that there's beginning to be some neighbourhood, you know, kind of protest about Airbnb. People aren't always happy about its impact on the neighbourhood, how it changes the neighbours, so there's not the same social relations, the rents are going up, so there must be some protest. So mapping that protest, and then in a way visualising it, so people can see that they're not alone, and that begins to encourage further resistance. But then working with that resistance to see what alternatives people are coming up with and sort of share their sort of practical knowledge. And I think that could also help to develop what Gala, and then talking to Mayo last night, you know, is the notion of an alternative sharing economy, because if in the process of using collaborative tools, the activists in different areas or people, citizens who are developing alternatives, you know, are also actually often beginning alternatives, like Hackney, you know, there is a lot of like social centres, cooperatives, and if they could connect with and know of similar cooperatives and social centres in other parts of London, and in a way develop a sort of sharing economy through platform cooperatives or sort of commons, and overcome that problem, which is that resistance and alternatives are often highly distributed,
I
and that's,
passa és que moltes vegades
the state obviously is in some sense a platform or a coordinating body, and it has also some distinct powers, like powers of land ownership,
taxation, and so on.
So maybe there does need to be a way in which we can link horizontally. So
just an
example of that could have been, say, childcare. I mean, Mayo stressed the importance of learning from feminism and making that kind of a central issue. And certainly in the government of London, we recognised domestic labour as a part of our economic strategy. So
we have an economic sector
on domestic production. And what we found is that already, you know, there was a whole network of childcare initiatives across London, very varied and not really knowing each other.
Now
just imagine if we had a childcare platform,
you know,
in which people were able to
both,
present their experiences and then share ideas and then maybe share resources. I mean, toy libraries could be kind of across different parts of London. Or, you know, we also had laundrette. We funded a laundrette, you know, taking domestic labour, not just about reproduction, but also about washing, you know. And so we funded a laundrette. And imagine if that had been spread. So in every estate, there was a laundrette. Anyway, these are just sort of ideas of where if we had IT tools, we could be actually producing new kinds of production. So it wouldn't be just about consultation and participation in policymaking, but actually about facilitating an alternative kind of economy. So I'll end there. And then, so in a way, that's just to say, you know, we must kill the ghost of Thatcher, this idea that there isn't an alternative. Because what she did was to not just say, Tina, there isn't an alternative, but actually to make sure there wasn't. You know, she would destroy any attempt to build one. So we're sort of rising from the dead and showing that we can develop one now. So in a way, the memory of the GLC, which young people are now documenting, is a resource for you, I hope.
Ens pot servir d'inspiració per això, com és un jove que està fent per documentar-ho. Moltes gràcies.
Okay, thank you. I have to excuse Gala because has to leave.
Excusar la Gala perquè ha de marxar.
We would like to open 10 minuts questions and one
un to de preguntes de 10 minuts per Anna i Hillary.
Thank you.
Moltes gràcies.
We had a phrase. We, you know, your point about time, which we very much suffered from too. We talked about the tyranny of the immediate, because we were just always having to go to meetings for good reasons. So
actually, we have a meeting with a public meeting with the mayor.
De fet, era una reunió pública amb l'alcaldessa a Gavà.
After at 6:30, okay, you can join us after bits.
Hi ha de ser a quarts de 6, però quarts de 7, però potser ens podem veure després. Si hi ha alguna pregunta per les nostres ponents.
A quick question.
Una pregunta ràpida. El micròfon no... Qui és el millor aliat amb aquesta lluita per espai públic i habitatge més just, i quina és la pitjor amenaça? Com veieu?
Sorry, again, who are our allies?
Qui són els nostres aliats?
Which is the biggest threat?
I quina seria la més gran amenaça contra aquest moviment emergent de recuperar la ciutat? Cap altra pregunta?
Or criticisms, or challenges.
O crítiques, qüestionaments.
Okay.
Second. second follow question. How this ISIS thing in Europe changes
tot això d'ISIS a Europa, de quina manera pot canviar o desafiar aquesta qüestió de l'espai públic amb la gran securització de tot l'espai que estem vivint ara?
Well, first of all, thanks for sharing both of
primer
you
moltes gràcies per compartir les vostres idees de la vostra experiència a Londres, l'actual i la del passat. És molt interessant per Barcelona.
And there is, some similarity when
I
it
comes
to similituds also what Anna was describing about
amb el que descrivia Anna de Londres, que Barcelona està seguint un model semblant quan es tracta del turisme, de desregulació del turisme i l'impacte del sector immobiliari a la ciutat, i també l'arribada de les empreses de fintech, de financeres tecnològiques, que sembla que s'han anat de Londres després del Brexit i ara venen cap a Barcelona, que se'ls ha pintat una mica com el paradís d'aquestes noves tecnologies.
Jo
acabo de venir de Londres, he viscut allà 8 anys i he trobat moltes similituds i evidentment és molt diferent com el govern aborda tota aquesta qüestió. Tenim un model molt urbà en el qual estem obrint els espais als ciutadans i també tenim aquests projectes de les superilles, que és molt diferent de l'espai privatitzat que vosaltres descriviu. Però tota la diferència dels models en com les ciutats estan competint i les empreses estan invertint i els mercats immobiliaris i les empreses financeres tecnològiques estan seguint més el model de Londres. Aleshores, no sé si teniu alguna reflexió que pugueu fer al respecte i també intentar captar els beneficis i d'atreure el talent, les parts positives del que significa ser una ciutat atractiva, perquè la gent continuarà venint, ja siguin turistes o empreses o gent de negocis amb talent, però el que volem evitar és convertir-nos en el pròxim Londres.
The mic is here. So in terms of solutions to the housing crisis in London.
Pel que fa a les solucions a la crisi d'habitatge a Londres i més globalment, em preguntava com ho veieu, quina mena de polítiques podrien diluir aquesta situació. Evidentment, hi ha una solució que ve per part dels moviments socials, que és part de l'estratègia, però en comptes de simplement anar a buscar
what would that be?
Quina mena d'estratègies podríem buscar per mitigar aquesta crisi d'habitatge? Perquè no és només a Londres, també a Nord-Amèrica, a Canadà, també segurament han estat els pioners de la fiscalització sobre els propietaris estrangers de propietat immobiliària. A Vancouver i a Toronto han imposat impostos pels propietaris estrangers de propietats immobiliàries que no estan ocupades, o sigui, han de pagar fins al 50% del seu valor en impostos, que potser és una bona solució per millorar la mobilitat del capital, però fins a quin punt penseu que és realista? Quina mena d'agenda política es podria fer servir a Londres i que podrien anar-se creant a partir dels moviments socials?
Okay, so lots of questions.
Moltes preguntes a la vegada.
In terms of the biggest ally and the biggest threat,
major aliat i la major amenaça,
big threat una gran that comes to mind, and it's part of the rental market Airbnb discussion that I was keen actually to ask Carla about if she hadn't had to go,
is that
this is an economy which is pitting people against each other. So if you have property, you can make money from property, and if you don't have property, you are excluded. And that is the huge challenge, I presume, for them when they're trying to work out how to tackle Airbnb and similar platforms.
poden abordar tot això, com en Airbnb i altres plataformes,
i
simplement recollir dades sobre les propietats i les dades d'Airbnb no és el tema.
City Hall run platform isn't the issue. The issue is what it's doing to the rental market.
Dirigida
and how do you tackle that?
Well, that starts to get into the much wider issues that Evgeny's asking about.
How do you tackle a housing crisis based on casino economy,
speculation, displacement, real estate bubble. Casino que tenim ara mateix, so que simplement l'únic que fan és crear desplaçaments i immobiliàries.
Question
tant,
about
aquesta seria la més
ISIS
gran amenaça.
And how that challenges
respecte
the security situation.
I mean, everything tot el que he dit abans
space,
sobre la privatització de l'espai públic i la seguretat que això porta, evidentment, tota la gent contra el terrorisme
és una gran part de tot això, the privatization of public space was happening anyway, but 9/11 gave it a massive boost.
Ja estava en marxa, però evidentment
I think rolled out, but now it's,
de l'11 de setembre li va donar moltíssima força a tota aquesta gent que ja tenia.
I mean, the sort of broader picture is that the spatial segregation that you see in cities
la segregació dels espais que veiem a les ciutats, a tota Europa, a París, que hi ha els barris benestants i després la perifèria desfavorida i els problemes que tenen amb totes les comunitats que se senten abandonades. Tot això entraria perfectament dins aquesta agenda de seguretat que ells tenen. Veiem el mateix a Londres. Estem exportant gent pobra o gent
as well as our
casa,
classes from London at the moment, and we're going to have we're already seeing
a sort
of outer ring of parts of outer London, Barking, Edmonton, where these sorts of things are happening there. So it's sort of all directly linked.
Tot està directament relacionat.
The biggest ally, I mean, I think the networking of collaborative movements which are growing up and the sorts of things that Hillary was saying.
Tot això que Hillary ha estat
somehow we have to use those sorts of tools that GLC was using so well
to bring all the protest groups in London together utilitzava també per ajuntar tots
we don't have a London government and the resources to do that.
De la qüestió de l'habitatge, nosaltres ara no tenim aquest govern,
which we don't,
però
el tenim, but you also have a much more
aquí, o vosaltres ara teniu aquí un ajuntament molt més...
But I think Hillary's point about working with dissent
un moviment de protesta molt més cohesionat.
Really well functioning participatory democracy is a really
una forma de promoure aquesta participació democràtica.
Perquè radical left governments when they come to
què passa
power,
quan els governs d'esquerra radical arriben al poder, que la gent moltes vegades
sort of
es desil·lusiona.
Work within that. And the
perquè hem d'intentar treballar
really
dins les estructures del poder. I el Great London Council havia aconseguit fer això, i potser perquè com que Thatcher era una enemiga tan enorme, era molt unificadora pels
but
moviments.
Yeah, I think a lot to learn from the GLC. How can Barcelona avoid the London model?
I com pot
well,
Barcelona
I mean, I think there are some
model de Londres, anar pel mateix que no.
Well, there are actually some really simple things that cities can do, which
hi ha algunes coses molt senzilles que les ciutats podrien fer i que no necessàriament comporten uns
kind of
grans canvis de polítiques
level.
O una gran intervenció a nivell nacional.
Local
es poden fer a partir
just
dels ajuntaments.
Like
i són
local
coses
intervention
com les
in local
intervencions
locals
en els mercats locals
space in the city.
Per
you know, just ring-fencing
conservar
some space
un espai assequible
like
dins la ciutat i també perquè hi hagi espais per negocis
housing,
assequibles, per artistes,
here,
per habitatge, i poder dir, ho podem fer aquí, ho podem fer allà, i aquestes
and
zones no es poden
London
tocar, estan destinades a això. I això és el que també va fer molt bé Londres durant aquest període del Great London Council als anys 80, que hi havia un moviment molt fort d'artistes i estudiants que van tenir un efecte molt fort
on making sure artists could stay affording to live in large areas, you know,
continuar vivint en diferents zones al llarg de tot Londres. I també el moviment dels ocupes també va ser molt important, evidentment després està completament erradicat del mercat immobiliari, però aquí encara és molt més viu i crec que tot això també s'ha de reconèixer com a aliats. Per tant, hi ha moltes solucions
can
de petita escala a nivell d'urbanisme que es poden anar
on a much bigger scale. You know, what are the solutions to the housing crisis in London, for example? To be quite honest, I don't think there are any solutions within the current paradigm
we
cannot just sort of tinker around the edges. It has to be something which is a step change, you know, away from where we're at, to sort of actually get anywhere. And we have to have a willingness to look at things really differently before we can do that. I mean, there's a list, we could come up with a list of good things.
Podríem aquí produir un moment una llista de coses com impostos comunitaris com han fet a Vancouver.
But we just need such a huge shift. You know, we need a massive house building program or genuinely affordable housing for people. I mean, Jeremy Corbyn says he's going to introduce that, but that is so counter the ideological model that we've got in place with this new housing act that has just been introduced, that is going to really change
serà
things
molt difícil
in London,
que canviï les coses
that.
A Londres, a partir sobretot d'aquesta nova llei de l'habitatge
que acaben
de promulgar.
You said work with rebel councils.
També deies que l'havia de treballar amb els ajuntaments rebels i encoratjar els consells de districte de Londres rebels. N'hi ha, els dir, a molts d'aquests projectes que hem parlat de diferents parts de la ciutat,
by the right of the Labour Party.
Tots,
so, you know, Jeremy Corbyn might have won the Labour leadership on the basis of a massive popular vote, but Labour councils are not reflecting that.
El líder,
so,
gràcies al vot popular, però yeah, no, just on that, I mean, ajuntaments laboristes no reflecteixen això.
A mayor who, you know, who, I mean, there's quite a strong left momentum group in Hackney.
Ara hi ha un grup de molt d'esquerres a Hackney.
So we push for this mayor who, he's not like,
i l'alcalde que tenim no és corbinista, però està més a l'esquerra del que estava. Però està com una mica nerviós, és el que l'en deia. I penso que si vingués a una reunió amb aquestes ciutats rebels, potser tindria el valor que li falta.
You have 18 estate demolition projects in Hackney, though. Yeah. Do you think he's going to stop them?
18 projectes de tirar a terra cases. Penses que els aturarà tots? Bé, penso que necessita suport.
I'm just looking to, this is a bit unfair to come here and say, please support our little rebel.
Em sembla que és una mica injust venir aquí i dir, doneu suport als nostres districtes rebels.
I mean, historically in Britain, there have always been, you know, there was Poplar, and then there was, what's that place in Derbyshire?
Derbyshire.
Skinner's place. Anyway, there've been like councils that have been like one, but it's been like a beacon of. Anyway, so we just.
No, and I mean, I think that is going
to
change.
Que les coses canviaran.
I just wanted to
see. Yes, no, that's good to be.
Però no volia interrompre.
Have you finished?
Yeah, I'm done.
T'has acabat? Sí, sí, acabat.
What Anna said. So,
a partir del que ha dit l'Anna.
Amenaces. In a way, what you said about
international
big, you know, financial investment, like
sobre aquestes inversions
Qatar
internacionals
from,
de Qatar,
China
de la Xina,
the Middle East, Saudi Arabia,
d'Aràbia Saudita.
Penso
que això és una amenaça bastant gran, perquè això portarà un seguit
de
compres que es faran per
on a completely
speculative, llogar, o es compra de manera completament especulativa.
Building on what Eugenie said, you know, project. I mean, that's what they're doing, and I think
és el que estan fent, i penso que això és una gran amenaça.
And I think the allies are
i els aliats.
A movement, some shift
són
in the Labour Party.
Moviments, canvis al Partit Laborista.
I mean, maybe some kind of shift in public opinion.
Potser un canvi en l'opinió pública, també.
My nephew, just to give him a plug, is
an
architectural journalist on The Guardian.
És un periodista especialitzat en arquitectura,
you know,
que escriu per The Guardian.
By the experience, I probably by the influence of people like you.
Ha llegit de moltes persones, com per exemple l'Anna, i ara s'ha tornat més radical en els seus articles. Per tant, potser intentar influenciar la nova generació de periodistes o de persones més influents perquè canviïn o liderin aquest canvi de cultura. Perquè, si no, això destruirà la vida de Londres. I això lliga amb el que ha dit la Francesca sobre com podem evitar que Barcelona es converteixin en Londres, atreure talent. I això a vegades també és un repte per la ciutat.
You know, in a way, artists and talented people have been affected by this financialization. So often what happens is the classic, you know, artists move in. I mean, Manhattan is a good example. It's very hip. Right? You know, so artists move in, creative people move in. And then, meanwhile, then that increases the value, then the finance, finance capital moves in, and rents become unaffordable. So the artists
el capital del ballà i ja no, els artistes ja no poden permetre's viure allà i potser estan enfadats amb Londres i es traslladen a Barcelona. Per tant, per lluitar contra aquesta financialització del mercat de la vivenda, potser cal crear les condicions per tal que la gent creativa li agradi la ciutat.
The GLC did that so brilliantly, didn't it?
El Consell ho va fer de manera brillant perquè va tenir tota una sèrie de polítiques que van donar suport a això, van donar suport a això.
Es
podia ser un artista a Londres en una època en la que el Consell existia, que obtenien les condicions. Es tracta de fer la vida que sigui més agradable, per exemple, amb la iniciativa que deia de les guarderies. Les persones creatives, si es donguessin les condicions, dirien sí, sí, anem a Londres, i això passa menys i menys, i la gent, aquest tipus de persones potser es desplaçaran a Barcelona.
And then I think, you know, there are national I think issues. Gala said rightly, we've got to go beyond tax, but land value tax, I think,
impostos,
you know, would be a crucial issue. I don't know if it's on Corbyn's agenda, but it should be.
Una cosa
and sort of exposing all these empty buildings, so
I
a mixture of
que hi ha
public data,
and then having buits, citizens,
I think
dades.
There was some area I was hearing about how, you know, there was a process of citizens going round their locality, identifying all the
hi havia un lloc on les persones anaven al voltant del barri mostrant quins edificis estaven buits. Perquè l'especulació a vegades és un procés invisible, però les persones en aquella zona anaven i ho van escampar pels mitjans, per les xarxes socials, la gent envoltava l'edifici. Hi havia també pràctiques d'ocupació d'edificis.
That we have to finish because
penso que ho hem de deixar
Anna
aquí perquè l'Anna ha de marxar.
Ah, okay.
No, no he de marxar.
Somebody...
I know,
algú
but I
ha dit.
I don't.
No, però no he de marxar.
Sí, ahora. Bueno, yo no soy Galapín. y como Galapín se ha tenido que ir, voy a hacer un pequeño cierre de 2 minutos. Bueno, primero quería dar gracias a las ponentes, los ponentes que han estado antes, a toda la gente que habéis venido y a las 500 personas que nos han seguido por stream. Y bueno, y solo decir que este ha sido como un primer paso, que ha sido el lanzamiento, y esperemos que el proyecto BITS se convierta en un laboratorio teórico y práctico de cómo construir esta soberanía tecnológica, no solo en Barcelona, sino a nivel internacional. Y los próximos meses habrá no solo un gran evento en el 7 y 8 de diciembre, 8 y 9 de diciembre, sino también seminarios de aprofundamiento, eso es en italiano, de profundización. Y esperemos contar con todos vosotros para poder construir este proceso colectivo para ir más allá y conquistar más grado de soberanía tecnológica. Y os doy las gracias por venir. Espero que nos podáis seguir por las redes sociales para ver un poco las novedades que hay, y lo dicho, muchas gracias por venir.